Organic chemistry seems to get more complicated by the day. Chemists allegedly just broke an important bonding rule and created impossible molecules. But did they really? In this video, we will dissect the history and chemistry of Bredt's rule, a guideline that many students will remember. However, they will also remember that frustratingly, there are exceptions to almost everything in chemistry. So let's figure out if our precious textbooks are safe or not. So who or what is Bredt? Julius Bredt was an OG German chemist working under the likes of legends like August Kekulé, who we know well from our discussion of Kekulén or so-called superbenzene. These early days of chemistry were quite crazy because modern analytical methods did not exist yet. More often than not, chemists did not know the structures of the molecules they were toying around with. A prime example was the molecule benzene, for which Kekulé famously suggested the correct structure with alternating single and double bonds back in 1865. You might remember he claimed to have received the inspiration during a dream reminiscent of the Ouroboros, the snake that eats its own tail. I told you, these days were crazy. A similar topic of debate was the structure of camphor. This pleasantly smelling terpenoid natural product is found in camphor and other trees, and saw a move towards large-scale use for the plastics industry in the 1870s. Various chemists proposed pretty freaky structures, including the master Kekulé himself. However, it was Julius Bredt who identified camphor's real structure with a bridged bicyclic ring system. He would spend years validating his findings and correcting the errors of his predecessors. Bredt's famous rule originated from these in-depth camphor studies, as he was not able to synthesize certain derivatives as planned. One of the first examples was this anhydride with a double bond at the bridged position. Elimination of a brominated precursor, or alternatively a condensation reaction of an unsaturated precursor, did not prove fruitful. After many synthetic attempts and encountering more quote-unquote impossible olefins, Bredt formalized his guideline and correctly hypothesized that ring strain is the culprit. But what is the source of that ring strain? And when is this rule really valid? And how strained are these forbidden rings really? So we all know that normal olefins are completely flat with a coplanar arrangement of substituents. However, involving a bridgehead creates an e-alkene, where a substituent on one carbon is connected to another one on the other carbon. If there are only few carbon atoms in this bridge, they would need to stretch out to ridiculous proportions to accommodate for this ideal planar geometry. So, the molecule tries to find a middle ground regarding ring strain and distortion. This means our double bond is not coplanar, but becomes twisted in small rings. This twisting leads to a suboptimal overlap of the p orbitals in the pi bond, which is also destabilizing. Speaking of p orbitals, remember how normal alkenes are sp2 hybridized? In the anti-Bredt olefin, we see a significant rehybridization to sp3 character as the carbons are pyramidal. This reorientation is key to boost the bond order to a surprisingly high value of 1.86. We have good evidence to believe that these are actually legit double bonds and not something like a di-radical. More on this later. We have seen why the system is destabilized and strained, but how strained is it? You might know that some thermodynamics shenanigans called homodesmotic equations can help out. Essentially, we are comparing the total strain energies of the saturated and unsaturated molecules to evaluate the pure strain contribution of the anti-Bredt double bond. Such computations were established in the 1980s as physical organic chemists tried to understand the limits of these olefins based on their size and strain energy. Here it becomes useful to quantify the size of a bridged ring by simply adding up the number of atoms in the bridges. The pioneers found that the strain estimation can pretty accurately predict if an olefin is stable at room temperature, whether it's only observable at lower temperatures, or whether it's so unstable that we can't observe it or form it at all. Small rings are very strained, while larger bridged rings can increasingly accommodate the desired olefin geometry without all the energy penalties. The quest to synthesize such larger ring systems started in the mid-20th century as the legendary chemists Prelog and Ruzicka investigated the limits of Bredt's rule. When they exposed this compound to forcing acidic conditions, they found something quite surprising. The ester group is just a bystander, so with acid and heat, it hydrolyzes and decarboxylates. But what happens now? The remaining two ketones can engage in an aldol condensation. As you might expect, condensation driven by the most accessible enolizable site gives a normal bicyclic product. But this was only a minor product. The major one actually comes from enolization at the alpha position of the other ketone. If you aren't asleep, you will notice that this is a bridgehead olefin. This means we kinda broke Bredt's rule already more than 70 years ago. The system at hand has a S value of 9, just like the molecule we had seen previously. The larger ring size reduces the olefin strain, which is why we can even isolate it. By the way, if you're enjoying this so far, make sure you've seen my other videos, which are even cooler than this one. Thanks for watching, and a special thanks to all my channel supporters. You guys are the best. By the way, don't panic about the rule being broken. Every chemistry student will know that rules are violated all the time, like Markovnikov's or Baldwin's rules. Rules in chemistry are not strict laws, but more like guidelines. And even Bredt himself predicted late in his career that some exceptions will pop up. Over time, chemists figured out that such rings even occur in natural products out in the wild. Prominent examples are the anti-cancer compound Taxol or the CP molecules, another set of classics in total synthesis, which have a S ring size of 8. We will not cover total synthesis here, but the chemistry connoisseurs will remember that Taxol's bridged ring was linked up through a McMurray-Pinnacle coupling. This reaction had a low yield despite what Professor Nicolau called a good deal of systematic study. So you know they tried hard to optimize it. After this landmark synthesis, dozens of other approaches were established, and some of them also include the more obvious Diels-Alder reaction to create the cyclohexene that is embedded within the bridged ring with the anti-Bredt olefin. So these are some really naughty natural products. By the way, can we appreciate this hilarious table of contents image? This gem was taken from an interesting paper that revisited the classification of stability based on olefin strain. It turns out that all known natural products are predicted to be isolable given their relatively modest strain. As we've seen, this comes from the larger rings. This means we need to evolve our understanding of Bredt's rule. First, it loses its relevance for rings with high S values or low olefin strain. Second, even the smaller ring olefins are not categorically inaccessible. But how can we tell if it's impossible to form these, or if they are simply very, very unstable? Well, over the last decades, chemists brought forward clear evidence for these anti-Bredt olefins, even ones with S values below 7. Most of these used trapping experiments to capture these short-lived species, like one norbornene here as an example. In this case, the chemists ran a lithium-halogen exchange reaction of this dihalo precursor in the presence of furan. As they isolated the corresponding Diels-Alder adducts, it seems reasonable to assume that an anti-Bredt olefin with S equals 5 was formed and very rapidly intercepted by furan. Even more impressive is this case with a S value of 7. Considering the delicate nature of the product, it seems really ironic that the chemists made it by brute force pyrolyzing this quaternary ammonium precursor through a Hofmann elimination. They also did some nice trapping, but even managed to get NMR data at minus 80 degrees Celsius. This is really remarkable and the only case to date of a theoretically unstable anti-Bredt olefin being observed directly. Evidently, using the total ring size S as a proxy for stability also doesn't work every time. This means claims of impossible anti-Bredt olefins should be taken with a big spoon of salt. The question is not if they can be made, but rather if there are more practical approaches and any synthetic utility. We might not be satisfied with having to incinerate our molecules to get crappy yields. This is where a new study from the Garg lab comes in. This research group is well known for elucidating and leveraging strained intermediates. Loyal viewers will remember the out-of-the-box synthesis of lysodendoric acid A, a sponge-derived natural product. There we saw that a fluoride-triggered elimination generated a crazy cyclic alene, and to up the ante, it's even chiral. Its strain energy of roughly 30 kilocalories per mole is lower than anti-Bredt olefins, but still not a joke. They managed to stereospecifically trap it in two ways. In addition to our good old friend furan, they found that an electron-deficient diene preferentially reacted with the other double bond. Other species hunted down by this lab include benzines and cyclotrienes, which have even higher strain energies, similar to our small anti-Bredt olefins. So it didn't seem completely impossible to tame these species as well. But we first have to reliably make them. The logic was very similar to what we've seen in the synthesis of lysodendoric acid A. A fluoride source would be used to convert the silyl substituent into an electrophage and allow the departure of a leaving group. You will remember that the first synthesis of the 2-2-1 olefin used lithium halogen exchange. So it's very similar but also different. The fluoride approach was investigated by others in the late 70s, but with mixed success. One main challenge is that anti-Bredt olefins rearrange to try to get energetically more comfortable. This leads to side products like in the left example, where the olefin rearranged to a carbene prior to insertion into a CH bond. This literature precedent did note one successful 3+2 cyclo addition, but didn't report any yield, so it was likely low single-digit percent at best. The research by Garg reapplied the fluoride-mediated elimination, but found that the relative stereochemistry was critical. You see, the precursor with an equatorial silyl group proved unreactive even under forcing conditions, while its diastereomer was more useful. By computing the structures, the chemists realized that the reactive diastereomer features a relatively smaller angle between the silyl electrophage and the leaving group, because this is a syn elimination that requires overlap of the carbon-silicon sigma and the carbon-oxygen sigma star orbitals, a narrow angle is better. The equatorial diastereomer has a very large angle and low overlap, suppressing its reactivity. The chemists optimized the conditions by using anthracene as a trapping agent. They found success with a low temperature option using the classic fluoride source TBAF, or alternatively a high temperature option using cesium fluoride and tetrabutyl bromide. This is essentially a slow release source of TBAF, which helps to control the reaction. The high yield is remarkable, as you would expect 16 hours at 120 degrees to cause quite some damage. Well, it doesn't, and the experimental procedure is pretty simple. It's super obvious, but let me still call it out. Due to the extremely reactive nature of the ABO, the trapping agent needs to be present from the get-go and can't be added at a later point. So what's the scope of this method? Other trapping agents were less efficient, but a major improvement to what we knew before. We have furan and its aromatic friends, as well as 1-3 dipoles. They also saw good breadth in terms of anti-Bredt olefins, with some larger and functionalized rings being tolerated. If you're paying attention, you will have noticed that the figure reports diastereomeric ratios of products. But what stereoselectivity does this even refer to? Our anti-Bredt olefin is actually one specific diastereomer, with the hydrogen retaining a pseudo-axial position after the initial elimination. Remember that instead of a coplanar geometry, we said the system is twisted to a significant degree? Well, the epidiastereomer with a pseudo-equatorial hydrogen would be even more distorted, with larger twisting angles and more pyramidalization. This elevates its energy and explains why we don't see any cycloaddition products with an equatorial hydrogen at the carbon. If you're a nerd or just SpongeBob thinking about his beloved lysodendoric acid A, this should again remind you of the cyclic alenes. In that video, we saw that certain chiral alenes had a larger barrier to racemization and thus exhibited high stereospecificity in their cycloaddition reactions. What happens if we use an olefin precursor with just one chiral center? Here the chemists synthesized the symmetrical 2-2-2 ring with high EE through separation of diastereomeric derivatives. We've already seen the diastereoselectivity and stereospecificity of the reactions, so it shouldn't be too surprising, the chirality is fully transferred to the cycloadduct. This once again suggests a concerted elimination step and a chiral alkene with a high barrier to racemization and a low, if any, diradical character. You now know that the existence of even small anti-Bredt olefins was well established, so Bredt's rule was already plenty broken and advanced textbooks could already feature these exceptions. The new research confirms the current interpretation of Bredt's rule because, as expected, these olefins are hella unstable. Still, the computations and experimental methods have unprecedented breadth and practicality, so these intermediates are slowly getting into the reach of synthetic chemists. However, the structures of the trapping products are not common. But hey, maybe someone will use this as a genius shortcut to easily synthesize an uber complicated structure, or maybe this will encourage more rule breaking in other areas. Only time will tell, but for now, this is some pretty sweet chemistry. I hope you learned something new from this video, thanks for watching until the end. If you liked it, please leave a like, comment or subscription. I appreciate your support and I'm looking forward to seeing you again in the next one.